this year. Just hasn't said how. Next Sports Center after the basketball doubleheader with Dan and Kenny. I'm Bob Stevens.
I'm Brian Kenny.
Bye-bye.
First up, it's an ACC-SEC appetizer with a mix of the old and a touch of the new. Billy Donovan's cooked up some excitement in Florida, but tonight the Gators enter Coach Mike Krzyzewski's kitchen, where Duke has the ingredients for another Final Four run. Then at 9:30, things really heat up. A New England border war when the top-ranked UConn Huskies, led by Rip Hamilton and Colin Ellamine, look to feast on the upset-minded UMass Minutemen. A full plate of college hoop action, and it's up next. The Florida Gators are 5-0, looking for their best start since 1984. However, tonight they enter Cameron Indoor Stadium. The Cameron Crazies will be ready, and certainly so will third-ranked Duke. Hope you're having a good evening, everybody. Larry Beal, along with Quinn Buckner. Double trouble of sorts. A doubleheader for you tonight on ESPN, featuring two of the best teams in the country in UConn and Duke. Unfortunately, not playing each other, but some interesting matchups.
Well, I think so. I think when you have to look at Duke, the thing you have to think about, here's a team that has got as good a chance as anybody to get back to the Final Four. For the Gators, they got a lot of young players. Teddy DuPay, and you look at Mike Miller, who has a sprained ankle, but they're going into a hostile environment to try to play the Duke Blue Devils. That's going to be a difficult task for such a young team.
Yeah, how do those freshmen handle going into Cameron? I mean, it's one thing when you're playing Bethune-Cookman and you're feeling pretty good. It's another thing against Duke. That's the story tonight. Guys like Avery and Langdon getting set. So are Brad Nessler and Len Elmore. They'll have the call when we come back.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of NCAA basketball is brought to you by the complete line of 1999 Lincoln automobiles. Lincoln, what a luxury car should be. And by the Olive Garden. When you're here, your family.
The rafters of Cameron Indoor Stadium in Durham, North Carolina, sold out. Number 3 Duke against Florida. Brad Nessler and Len Elmore with you. We welcome you. Billy Donovan's got to be hoping his kids aren't looking at those lights up there with all those banners for Duke. His team comes in unbeaten, but untested, really. They're so green. Duke once beaten Len, and you saw that up in Alaska.
Absolutely, and the way Cincinnati beat Duke was by attacking 3 areas. The first one is William Avery. You can't let him turn the corner as you look at him in a spot shadow. You got to make him give it up. A lot of times, Duke will turn the ball over, averaging about 18 turnovers a game. Trajan Langdon, get in his grill. Don't let him get any light for any jumpers. And finally, Elton Brand, you got to bump him off his spot. Push him past the dotted line and force him to take a shot outside his range. You got to remember, Duke contributed to that loss by not playing the usual intensity that they have in defense.
Starting lineup for Billy Donovan. Here's how it looks. There are actually 2 sophomores in the starting lineup, but Halton DuPay and Haslam, the 3 freshmen. Major Parker starting for Mike Miller for the 3rd straight game, but Miller will play after missing 2 games with a bad ankle. For Mike Krzyzewski and the Duke Blue Devils, here's how they look. Avery and Langdon in the backcourt, Battier and Carwell up front, and Elton Brand coming off a career high game of 26 points in the 20-point win over North Carolina State over the weekend. Mike Krzyzewski, 19 years and 439 wins here, 512 overall, and 7 Final Fours. And in this building, his teams almost never lose.
Well, tonight, I'm sure he's going to want his guys to jump on Florida quickly, recognizing this is a young team, inexperienced, and they've never seen anything like this before. Look at the Crazies.
Billy Donovan, almost as young as his team at age 33, and we're underway. Controlled by Duke.
Florida opens up in a man-to-man. Today they practice an awful lot in staying close, forcing guys to put it on the floor.
And they didn't start the clock, and that's why the horn sounds, as Langdon took a flying 5-footer. And that'll get the kids into it here. The officials that stop play, that's Frank Scagliata that's over there at the scorer's table. Andre Petillo and Carl Hess, the other 2 officials.
Billy Donovan asking, don't penalize the defense. We played some pretty good D on that one.
Defense, 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 defense. There's Dupe, the young point guard, Elton Brand. After missing 15 of Duke's 36 games last year with injury, came back well before anyone anticipated he would. And this year has just picked up where he left off. 16 and a half points and 10 rebounds a game.
The last year you absolutely saw the growth in Elton Brand, but it was stymied by the injury. This year he's playing like a man possessed, the type of player that Mike Krzyzewski thought he'd be at the end of last year.
We had problems with the clock at the Grade 8 last week. I had problems in Freedom Hall last night. In fact, at a couple of times, it even put up Louisville's name up there instead of Kentucky and Indiana. I don't know if it's me that the clock problems are following me around the country or not. I'm
well,
not
let's
sure.
Let's see. Is your wristwatch working?
Yeah, it's still going.
Oh, you got one of those expensive ones.
8 seconds in, Florida will start against some backcourt pressure from Duke.
And this is what Duke wants to do. They want to jump on the young backcourt of Florida right away to see what their mettle is.
Parker, here's Dupe at the point. Nice entry pass by Dupe. Got it in, but Haslam had it stripped away. It comes free. Open jumper. A three-pointer won't go for Halton. And a push inside. There's what Florida has done so far. They are leading the SEC in scoring at 88 points a game. Of course, they have not played a conference game yet. And their opposition hasn't been the strongest, though they were impressive against Florida State. Here's a steal by Brand. Got Langdon on the flank. He'll take it himself.
You talk about Elton Brand. Most of the time you describe him by size, but he's got the quickness. He's got the dexterity.
Just took that one-man break in for the first two of the ball game. Turnaround jumper on the baseline and a strong move by Udonis Haslam. Carwell inside to Brand. He's doubled down low and pushed on the baseline.
Again, we'll take a look at Elton Brand on the steal and taking it coast to coast. Here you see a mishandle by Florida, and there's Brand handling the ball. Big guy, 6'8", 260. He's got a little bit of style to his game, a little hesitation.
Gave a little look off and went up for it. Avery inside Battier. Offensive foul, and Dupe takes the charge.
A nice job by Teddy Dupe. A mismatch with Shane Battier that he had to guard him down low. And even Dupe, recognizing you can't give the Duke guys any room to shoot, steps right up, sticks his chest in there.
Battier may not have known he was there. Teddy gave away about a foot.
But when you look over your shoulder and you're 6'9", you're not going to see him right away.
Nobody home. Mike Miller into the lineup, and the entry pass inside Haslam. Strong move against Brand.
Hey, Udonis Haslam kind of matches up with Elton Brand, almost size for size, inch for inch, and pound for pound. That time, a nice job on the block.
And Haslam has dropped some pounds to get down to where he is, and they are very much the same size. This time, Brand faces up, and the jumper is off the mark, and the rebound comes off to Eddie Shannon.
And Billy Dolliman can live with one shot and out for Duke. His guy's doing a nice job of blocking off the boards.
Right inside, Haslam. Goes up and is fouled by Battier.
Shane Battier known to take charges. He's taken 10 thus far this year, 5 in 1 game. That time he tried to peel back and help out. Right now, nice little entry pass inside, and Haslam pretty nimble himself. You see Battier coming over. That's one thing Florida has to be cognizant of. Shane Battier, a master at stepping in the line of fire and taking one for the team.
Two quick ones on Battier. And the free throw good by Haslam. Burgess comes in, Maggette comes in. So off to a great start, Udonis Haslam. There's his field goal numbers, and he's hit two tonight. He's 22 of his last 31 from the floor.
Interestingly enough, Florida just content playing a half-court type of defensive style. We know they've got some pressure D in them. Billy Donovan being a Rick Pitino disciple.
And a push way outside. And that's going to be on Haslam. Haslam. So he's got early foul trouble as well.
That was an example of Florida looking to double team Avery, not let him turn the corner and make him give it up, just as we mentioned in the beginning of the telecast.
Eddie Shannon, hopefully you saw the sensational story by Curry Kirkpatrick on Eddie Shannon on SportsCenter just before we came on the air. Having lost his sight in his right eye, and you see him wearing the goggles, and he's instant offense. He's been a good player, and his stay at Gainesville, one of the co-captains. Well, I think that's offensive interference.
You see the benefits of making William Avery give the ball up. Chris Burgess, a good player, a decent offensive player, still shooting out of his range that time.
Here's Dupe, shouted by Avery up court. Trying to sneak through and did, left the ball off. Miller picked up the loose ball and scored. Kind of a gift to give the assist to Dupe, but that isn't the guy he was trying to feed it to. And it's an 8-2 lead for Florida.
Thus far, no back down by Florida. Young players are trying to feed off of this Florida, this Duke crowd.
Well, they've withstood the early onslaught that Billy Donovan was afraid of, because there hasn't been one from Duke so far. We're just not even 3 minutes into the ball game, but it's been a Florida onslaught so far.
And definitely inside the paint, Florida looking to play inside, outside. They know that a strong inside game opens up the three.
And Trajan Langdon drops in the 258th of his career.
You give him a sliver of daylight, and he'll use it to burn you.
He had 17 in the first half against Michigan State in the game I saw for the Grade 8 in Chicago last week, and he was just lighting it up. Didn't shoot much in the second half, didn't have to. He gets on a hot streak, look out. Shannon, he's going to try one from the baseline, and Eddie drops it in.
Well, one of the things Billy Donovan talked about with his team is that they still don't understand how to use the three. That time they used it nicely within the flow of the offense, and we'll talk about that more as the game goes on.
Stolt clears off the rebound. Here's Miller on the run. Nice. Down low. Nice. Good feed. Brand with a foul and a block all in one move there.
I'll tell you something. Mike Miller's showing me that he can handle a ball at 6'8". He's done a nice job on the previous possession of three with Shannon. He's creating the opportunities. There he is, catches on the run. Nice little feed and avoids the offensive foul. Florida pushing the ball up. They're dangerous when they do that. They've got some athletes, and a nice job by Miller.
Boy, Langdon took one in the kisser for nothing on that one. Miller ran him over, and Brand picks up the foul. Duke a little bit frustrated here early, trailing by six with 16:35 to go in the first half. Brent Wright coming off a 15.5 rebound game in the win over Charleston Southern in the last outing for Florida. Battier comes back in, but he's playing with two fouls right now.
He also had six steals. This is a guy that leads the team in rebounding, and he can play center, but he's another one of those guys who has ball handling skills. You know, he's a basketball player. You can't really put him in a box.
Mm-hmm. So a 7-point advantage for Florida here in the early going. Langdon around a pick. That one's a little bit off. Rebound underneath, though, was strong, and a foul on Miller. Miller's got two.
Well, we talked about in playing Trajan Langdon, what you have to do is you got to follow him out on those screens. You can't try to go over the top. Otherwise, he's going to get daylight like that. But a great job by Corey Maggette on the weak side board. Never gave up position. You know, when you know that your teammate's about to take a shot and you're on the opposite side, you've got to root yourself in, clear out, and then go up strong.
Langdon gets a breather. Maggette hit the first free throw. Shooting 75% from the line. Missed the second. Ball went up and in, but a foul trying to get position for the rebound. I think they're going to call it on Stolt.
Yeah, unfortunately.
Oh, and they're saying the basket counts. Are you kidding me?
Double, unfortunately. Greg Stolt kind of fell asleep at the switch. Shane Battier is one of those guys that just doesn't quit. Watch him on the left side of your screen. Get in real quickly and just get a finger on. Well, actually, it was Stolt who tried to knock the ball away.
Greg Stolt.
And you talk about Christmas early.
Wow. This is a three-point play for Shane Battier. That's the weirdest looking three-point play we've seen so far early in the season.
That's a luxury right there when you got a Mike Miller who's so dangerous offensively that can bring the ball up against pressure.
The intensity picking up on Mike Krzyzewski's face and for his team. They still trail by three.
Take a look here. Big mistake by McGetty in reaching. In a situation like that, you just got to shadow the guy.
Eddie Shannon now run the point. Double teamed. Stolt, if you give him an opening, he'll drain the 3-2, but the ball comes loose. A steal by Battier. Florida's second turnover. And we're 4 minutes in. Duke with a chance to cut it to one or tie it on this trip. McGetty on the drive. Good move, didn't finish. And the rebound off to Wright. Wright drives the lane. Way off the mark with a shot, McGetty the rebound.
Good thought by Wright putting it on the floor, but he never looked up to the basket in order to finish. Gotta have the basket in sight, go up strong and attack the rim.
Avery, nice penetration, dishes to Burgess down low. 1 point game.
Crossroads time for Florida. This is where the poise comes into play.
Nice crossover dribble by Shannon. Freed him momentarily. Here's Miller for three. Got it.
Little ice water there. Nice job and execution by Florida, moving the ball, not taking the opportunity to beat somebody off the dribble, staying within their offense. And that's what you have to do when you're pressed. You got to stay and execute your game plan.
Three on the other end from downtown Durham by Avery. Cuts it down to a 1 point game again. Shannon penetrates, leaves it for Wright in the paint. Avery clears off the miss. Duke's only lead was 2-0. And Battier bumped en route. It's going to be a foul on Greg Stolt, his second. Florida, though, in front with 14-13 left first half.
When legs are sore, when backs ache, when muscles hurt, why sports cream? Rubbing it in brings fast pain relief. No medicine-y smell. Why sports cream? Because it works.
Larry Beal in the studio. Sneak peek at Wisconsin and Temple. The Owls have lost three in a row. Here are the Badgers. Ty Calderwood to Mike Kelly for three. And the Badgers trying to go 8-1, leading at the half 33-29.
Here, Florida pulling the early surprise, 15-14. Murray State now has the top home record as far as winning streak after a win by Iowa last night over Kansas. You can log on to ESPN.com for all the latest in news in college hoops, news and notes. You can also talk with Gary Williams. Billy Donovan, Billy the Kid. Rick Pitino, protege, now in his third year. Mike Krzyzewski. We saw the guy he played under last night. Indiana lost in overtime to Kentucky. One seems like just yesterday, one seems like a long time ago, though.
Well, it depends on your frame of reference.
That's right.
The older you get, the quicker time goes.
Nice drive on the baseline by Nate James, who just checked in to give Duke the lead.
And that's what Duke has, the depth to keep coming at you with guys who can contribute right off the bat.
Seven guys have scored, Lenny, already for Duke.
And James has come in to give a spark on both ends. That time on the defensive end disrupts the Florida offense.
So now Florida with some full court pressure with Duke back in front by one. Gonna have to hurry. Got it into Burgess. Beg your pardon, that's Domzalski.
Take a look now. It looks like a little bit of half-court zone pressure by Florida right now. Just trying to step it up just a little bit as they go back into a 2-3 zone. Change of pace.
Langdon got his man in the air off the glass.
I said a little sliver. All he needs is just to get it out of his hand. Deadly accurate.
Duke with its biggest advantage up by 3. Parker around a pick, goes all the way and had it blocked. Domzowski also got him though.
And it's very important for Florida to continue to be aggressive going to the basket right there in their half court. Right here, you take a look. Nice up fake by Trajan Langdon. That's one thing that he's improved upon since his freshman year, the ability to create shots. When he came into the ACC as a freshman, he was merely a jump shooter, standstill jumper. But now he's a complete offensive player.
There's Major Parker, averaging about 6 points a game. His first point of this one. DuPay checks back in for Florida. And Avery back in for Nate James for Duke.
That's a matchup I think Mike Krzyzewski wants to have. Believe me, he's going to get the better of it. And William Avery has really shown, at least from the offensive end, that he belongs here. A lot of people question his ability to play the point. He's got those folks shaking their heads.
Parker got them both. Makes it a one-point game. Stolt goes out, and Najee came in for him.
Now we have a chance to see Florida's full court pressure. Reminds you of Kentucky a lot, where it all begins with the pressure on the ball. And you take a look at Wright with those long arms, quick feet. Domzowski is not the guy you want handling.
Nope. Gagliotta calls a backcourt foul. It's going to be on Parker. Don't forget, coming up tomorrow night at 8 o'clock on ESPN2, you don't want to miss the 8th annual Home Depot College Football Awards Show. Chris Lee and Kirk will all be there for the awards given to the top quarterback, the best all-around player, and a lot more. Find out if your favorite player is an award winner tomorrow night, 8 o'clock on the Deuce. Avery goes to the free throw line. In a 1-1, missed it, and Brand kept it alive. Knocked out of bounds, still Duke ball.
Florida's problem is on the free throw line for the second time, not putting bodies on folks. When that ball leaves the shooter's hand, you got to make sure you get a player in the white shirt on your back if you're a Florida defender.
Avery tried to penetrate, got double teamed, and Domzowski is tied up, and that's going to go to Florida. Nice job defensively by Parker, and that's a new rule this year. If you force a held ball like that, in that situation goes to the defense.
Take a look right here. There's a nice pass inside, but Domzowski puts it on the floor trying to go to the basket. That time, the Duke aggressive play going to the hoop worked against him.
That time, the intent of that new rule came up on the proper end. Right from the other end, missed a 3. Florida doesn't have anybody that's shy about taking the 3.
It's all part of the flow of the offense. If you get it in the flow, that's one thing. I don't think Billy Donovan wants his guys to try to create offense with the 3.
Brand wants to back in. Wheels on the baseline. Good looking move. Couldn't get it to drop. Carawell throws it back up there. And now we've got another jump ball, and the officials, Carl Hess and Frank Scagliotta, will determine whose ball that was. It's going to be Florida again.
Take a look at Elton Brand. Once again, a little fadeaway that time. Double teamed inside, but offensive rebounding. Duke's forte. Again, Brand comes in. Nice job by Wright that way to grab hold of possession.
That's one of those situations where the intent of the rule is a little bit clouded, because you really never knew who was the person with possession of the ball before it was a tie-up. And so we saw one clear-cut reason that rule was put in, and one why people think they're still questioning a little bit. DuPay on a runner.
Young man averaged about 41 and a half points a game. In
just 41 and a half a game.
That's right. And with running shots like that, getting them up in the air, you see why.
Burgess off a great feed from Carawell. Couldn't connect. Brand trying to pull it down. And it's knocked out of bounds. With 11:50 remaining first half, Florida with a one-point lead. Florida by 1. Teddy DuPay just hit the shot that put him ahead. He talked with us about playing in front of the Cameron Crazies.
I just want to take it more. It's an exciting gym to play in, not so much intimidating. I'm going to try and, you know, funnel all the electricity that the fans are sending out. I'm trying to use it the same way the Duke team is going to use it. I'm trying to get it to pump me up, get me to raise my game to another level. You know, I'm trying to use it as an advantage just as much as the other team will.
His first 2 points of the night, 3,744 in high school, broke Chris Corciani's Florida scoring record. Here's Carawell, backed in and off the glass.
And you talk about Teddy DuPay, his high school coach is the same high school coach, Frank Morris, who coached Billy Donovan in high school up in Long Island at St. Agnes. Had some pretty good teams up there as well.
Shannon had it blocked, but also was fouled. It went down hard. Either Brand or Burgess, they were both there. It's going to be a foul on Elton Brand. That's his second.
I think the one thing you have to be impressed by the young players, even though Eddie Shannon is a senior, is that Florida continues to play aggressively. They're not backing off. They're not going east-west. They're continuing to take the game to Duke, and that's something that's going to keep them in the game as long as they have the will to do that.
Eddie. And that point gives him 1,000 for his career at Florida. Needed 4 points, has a three-pointer and a free throw, so he's at an even grand. Now it's 1,001, five for Eddie and a one-point lead for Florida. Avery wide open for three. Way out there, and it's the second one he's hit that's been a bomb.
Not covering the shooters can mean a long night. That time out of the pressure. What happens when you beat the pressure is you have wide open opportunities from 15 or more.
Wright got free from Battier and buried the jumper. Brent Wright's first field goal, and we're deadlocked at 23. The second tie of the ball game. The first one was at 2-2.
But right now, Florida trying to pressure, change the tempo a little bit, and kind of feel Duke out with regard to how they handle it. They're going to be victimized, though, because Duke is such a great perimeter shooting team. Once you beat that wave of pressure, look at the open spots right there, because the defenders are scrambling back to pick up men. And if you don't pick up the right guy, and William Avery is the right guy, you're going to get hurt.
You don't expect a guy to be taking him from 25 feet. He's hit both of them from way out there.
All it takes is one. I tell you, when I saw him up in Alaska, he was burning folks from that deep. And then when you got up on him, he was able to put it on the floor and walk you to the cooker, which is the basket. For the uninitiated.
For the uninitiated? They're not watching tonight. The uninitiated aren't. Avery's got seven.
Stick with us. We'll initiate.
That's right. We'll burn right, everything right into your memory banks before it's all over. Got them both. Eight for Avery. From Cameron Indoor Stadium, almost the midway point of the first half. Brad Nessler and Len Elmore with you. The SEC against the ACC. And Florida doing a good job. They just turned it over, though, for the fourth time as Teddy DuPay got ahead of himself a little bit and traveled.
Up until now, Florida's been able to maximize most of their opportunities, at least get a shot up, hit the offensive glass. They've been taking the game to Duke, not showing any back down whatsoever despite their youth.
Avery's been the offense the last couple trips down court. Carawell short on a turnaround. Nice job of saving it by Najee. And that's Halton on the other end. Whoa! That might be a technical. 10:28. Clock stopped. Full day of basketball coming up Saturday on ESPN and ESPN2. First on ESPN, West Virginia travels to Philly to battle Villanova. And at 8:30, I'm going to take a look at Maryland taking on defending national champion number 5 Kentucky. And on ESPN2, Lenny, you'll see North Carolina and North Carolina Charlotte at 7, followed at 9, Michigan coming in here to take on third-ranked Duke. So the technical on hanging on the rim by Najee sends Trajan Langdon to the free throw line.
And this is purely brain lock right here. Najee not having a chance, no one under him. I guess he could probably say that it looked like a Duke player on the side of him. Might have been Battier. Might have brushed him a little bit. He was holding on to protect himself, but the officials didn't see it that way.
Trajan Langdon, who's virtually automatic from the free throw line, hits them both. And now it's a 4-point Duke lead. And the basketball, 27-23.
Another mini crisis for Florida, because Duke will utilize situations like that to go on one of their patented tears.
Carrawell had it partially blocked, still got the pass inside to Burgess. He'll try twice, still didn't go down. Langdon on a fadeaway. Well, Duke's certainly getting the opportunities this trip down, but they're not getting it in the basket.
First of all, that time Battier had his hand on the line and his hand on the ball, but no call for being out of bounds. Take a look here. Florida's scrapping. Even there, he's right there. His hand on the ball and hand on the line should have been an out-of-bounds call. But the fact is, getting very physical. And as we mentioned before, just because they're young, it doesn't mean that they're in awe of Duke.
Brent Wright gave Battier a little shove in the chest there as Battier was trying to plead his case to the officials. So we're at the midway point of the first half. Langdon. Battier keeps it alive.
Nice job by Battier again, holding his ground.
Avery, wow. Average length of three-pointer, about 25 feet. He's got 11, the lead is 7. You sit and worry all day long about the three-point shooting of Trajan Langdon, and all of a sudden, William Avery, as you said, when he gets going, look out, too.
Well, you credit this to Shane Battier with a nice offensive rebound right there, and then finding the open man who's dead on. Again, from a floor-level angle, you take a look at Avery. He just flows into that three. He's straight on anyway. That's the easiest three-point shot that you could possibly have. But we talked about Florida having poise. It took a mistake like Najee hanging on the rim to get a technical for Duke and give them possession. And they were able to stretch the lead out. Florida's got to continue to attack.
Florida known for its three-point shooting, but it's Duke that's doing the honors right now. Especially Avery, who's perfect, as you saw, 3 for 3. Dupe on the entry pass, Wright walked with it.
Right now, it seems to be unraveling for the young team.
Boy, they held their ground for about 9 minutes, but the last couple minutes, it's been all Duke. Blue Devils on a 7-0 run right now.
And this is what Duke has to learn as well, how to put teams away. You know, they can go out on the lead. They can certainly go on a tear, but you got to learn how to put a team away. Against Michigan State, they had a big lead. Michigan State came back on them.
And they turn the ball over. Avery palms it.
Which is indicative of how Duke has played. We talk about their turnover margin. You know, they force about 18.4 turnovers, but they turn it over themselves 18 times again. And again, that's conducive to giving leads back.
You're right. They had 29 forced turnovers against NC State over the weekend, Lenny. But as you said, they had 20 of their own. So hard to make that pay in your favor, right? Here's a three-pointer from Stoll. He's a good shooter when he can square up. Wright got it back. McGetty sent it back. That's got the crowd in camera.
No.
Oh!
Yes. You can see him readying. He doesn't know where that line is. All he knows is where he feels it.
He might take one from midcourt before this thing's over. Langdon with a steal. Feed underneath. Billy Donovan might want a timeout.
We said the young boys from Florida would have to withstand what Duke dishes out in their home. And right now, they don't like the taste of it.
Take it from the top. Take away the stress. Take care of yourself at Tenaz Hair Designs, a full-service day spa that offers a variety of hair treatments, tanning, massage, facials, pedicures, and more. Pamper that special person in your life with a gift certificate for any occasion. Tenaz Hair Designs, where our reputation is your good looks. With 5 triangle locations, call for your appointment today and let Tenaz take care of you.
Well, this is what a sorority house looks like. Come on!
120 top teams in the only college basketball game for the Nintendo 64. Fox Sports College Hoops 99. What are you doing? It's easier on your own than the real thing.
Go! Focus!
Sports games, Fox attitude.
All right, bring it in here, guys. Huddle up. Now listen up, fellas. We got a full house out there. They can't get to the Rockies, so let's bring the Rockies to them.
Right.
We got the coldest beer around. With Frostbrute, Coors Light, and our trades, there's no reason we shouldn't have a great day. Right. Now, what do they want?
Coors Light.
What do we got?
Coors Light.
What?
Coors Light.
I can't hear you.
Coors Light.
By a dozen, and how quickly it turned.
Well, all it takes is a few turnovers right here. Trajan Langdon appears to have saved it. The official right on it, and then a thundering dunk. Not only does it score you 2 points, but it, again, it continues to hammer away at the confidence, takes the spirit away of a young team.
That ball never touched out of bounds. It was about 2.5 feet out of bounds, but Langdon, with some backspin, got it back on the court. Shannon on the break.
It's got to make you feel good. You design a play out of a timeout that works for a layup.
Oh, my. Langdon as far out as Avery. Now it's becoming a contest.
The game giveth and taketh away. Whew. Just when you're feeling good about yourself.
Duke is 6 out of 8 from three-point range. Now watch the last one of Avery. I didn't think we could have another one this far out tonight.
Well, you talk about playing in their grill, getting up close so that they don't have any daylight. But you're right, Brad, as you mentioned before, when you're that far out, who would think that you take a shot? And Langdon says, I'm going to one-up you. I think there's a secret horse game going on here.
Wow. Free throw's good by Stoltz. That 6 out of 8.
And what that shows is that Florida has been unable to step up and get close to the shooters. Three-point shot is very difficult with a hand in your face.
It's difficult when they're taking them from 26 feet too.
You got to watch and admire.
Oh man. Carwell on the baseline. It's the shortest shot Duke's taken in about 5 minutes.
And one of the quickest as well. And again, that opens up the door for a team with experience and a hot hand to come back on you.
Three-pointer by Florida doesn't go. Battier pulls down the rebound, and he'll bring it down court. Almost had it stripped from behind. In fact, ball still loose, and it does come free.
And another turnover by Duke. We talked about the ability to put teams away. Still, obviously, plenty of time for them to go out by 20.
Miller, way out. Langdon got good position and comes down with a rebound.
Good job of blocking out.
McGetty, he's too strong. And the foul on Avery from behind. That'll be his first. 7:09 left in this one. A lot more basketball tonight, though, at 9:30. The Massachusetts game with number one Connecticut, led by All-American candidate Rip Hamilton, taking on the Minutemen of UMass. And Mike Tirico and Dick Vitale will be waiting to bring you that one when Lenny and I are done. There's what Rip's done so far, the Big East Player of the Year last season, almost 21 points a game this year.
And they're still dominating, although they lost a little ground in the polls to Maryland. But a lot of people are saying that UMass is down, and their record reflects that. Larry Kettner may not be playing as well as you would like him to, but when these two teams match up, you know, they're only right down the road from each other. You know it's going to be a war.
I'm looking forward to seeing your alma mater on Saturday night at Rupp. It's going to be fun to watch.
Yeah, that should be pretty interesting. I think Kentucky's going to have to shoot the ball a lot better than they have been. And they're going to have to get some good guard play as well, because Maryland pressure will expose any weakness in the backcourt.
Greg Stoltz hit both free throws to cut it to 10. Najee comes back in. I believe that's his first time on the court since the technical for hanging on the rim earlier. McGetty. Inside to James with the left hand, foul before the shot. And it's going to be on Brent Wright.
Well, everything was good for Florida that time. Good solid half-court defense, just a little bump. and puts Nate James on the line. On the other side of the ball, Duke comes down a little more deliberate than they've been on the last few possessions, where they've just fired it up. One pass and you launch.
Yep, they got a little sloppy and they got a little competitive on, I'm going to try to one-up you. Although that, I'm sure, wasn't their strategy. When they came down court, everybody was trying to get into the long-range shooting act.
But when you get in the film room or the video room later on,
well, Michael
turns
killed
out to be.
So James, who had a field goal early.
Did you hear me say film room? Boy, my date.
Uh-huh. Film, tapes, all the same.
They didn't have tapes when I played. That's the problem.
They taped your ankles. That was about it. 10-point game, 6:45 left first half. With Len Elmore, Brad Nessler with you, our ESPN crew at Cameron Indoor Stadium. Nice drive by Miller, but a foul before he got the shot away. And now Avery's got two.
Billy Donovan applauding the play by Miller. Once again, Florida getting back to aggressiveness. You've got to take the game to you. And here in Miller recognizes an opening. He takes no prisoners. Nate James took the weight of that blow.
Give that foul to James, too, not to Avery.
Take a look at the freshman right there. Not really getting off the way they'd like, although it's somewhat balanced. Haslam did some damage in the beginning of the first half. Dupe has really had to handle the ball in the face of an awful lot of pressure by the Duke backcourt.
Mike Miller, the 6'8 freshman. Most highly sought after player, I would guess, ever to come out of the state of South Dakota. Led his team to back-to-back state titles in Mitchell. Second one off the mark.
Had a chance to talk to him a little bit today, and the thing about it is he's such a quiet, unassuming guy. He gets till he gets the ball in his hands.
And Duke throws it away.
Again. And again, here's a situation where the point guard is not handling it. Trajan Langdon, I guess, is the point guard on the floor right now. Excuse me, since William Avery is sitting on the bench. And that's where Duke's had some problems.
Mike Krzyzewski has said that this team is a work in progress, and it does not have, obviously, Steve Wojciechowski, who has graduated. He was kind of the soul of the team and the guy that handled it the majority of the time. Now that ball handling is being passed around to several different players, and thus Mike says that's a reason for more turnovers. Eddie Shannon, nice little drive.
Good little hesitation by Shannon, recognizing again the defense wasn't set in that weave, and he found an opening down the lane. And once again, Florida taking the game to Duke. They've regained their confidence, and they're going to the hoop aggressively.
Eddie Shannon off the bench leads Florida in scoring and has him back to within seven as Carwell buries it. Three.
Nothing you can do about that. Miller in great position. Mike Carwell just does what he's supposed to do.
And now Brand comes up with a steal. The outlet to Burgess. Burgess on the bounce pass underneath to James. Picture perfect break after Brand steal.
Best transition game in the business right now when you take a look at Duke. Somehow when they go from defense to offense, they get people in the lane and they finish.
Wide open, he'll try one. Three rims out, Burgess will clear it off to Langdon. Brand is ahead of the pack, and Langdon didn't loft it up there. I thought we had an alley-oop coming. Instead, a steal by Shannon. Eddie Shannon.
Too sweet by Langdon, trying to go behind his back. You don't do that with an experienced point guard. Eddie Shannon's a senior, he knows what's up.
Eddie's leading Florida right now at the 10-point difference and 5:04 left in the first half. 22nd timeout. 11 points for Eddie Shannon, who's gone over the 1,000-point plateau in this first half and through his four-year career. Billy Donovan, last year his club went 14-15, 6-10 in a tough SEC, and they made the postseason for the first time since the 94-95 campaign. Lost to Georgetown in the NIT by a couple, but the folks down at the O-Dome in Gainesville are expecting much, much more with the recruiting class in everybody's top five. And obviously you're seeing a lot of those freshmen here tonight. But you're also seeing a 70% Duke team from three-point range, and thus a 10-point lead.
Take a look at that number right there. 9 second-chance points for Duke and none for Florida. So they've had to battle.
Carrawell tried a triple. Brand fought for the rebound and missed in close. Last touch by Florida.
Well, that's the lesson that Ladarius Halton is going to learn. He had an opportunity to save that ball. Whenever you have an opportunity to save, you got to do it, because you never know which way the officials are going to call it and what they've seen. Lost opportunity for Florida to gain possession.
Avery, nice crossover. Got a good pick from Burgess. And now Brand again trying to back in the lane. Squares up and missed in close again. Tough shot that time, though.
I tell you, Wright does a nice job bodying up with Brand and putting those long arms up in the air. Difficult for Brand at 6'8 to see over.
Najee, tough pass into Halton. And a foul before he got there. Trajan picks up his second.
Down low, you take a look here on the pass. I don't know.
Langdon just got a little bit tangled up, I guess, feet-wise, especially with Halton, and he'll go to the free throw line.
But Halton received cleanly and was able to go to the basket. I think he might have had his hand on the player, and that's where the call came in. Tough break for Trajan Langdon.
Langdon will sit so he doesn't get a cheap third one here with 4:21 in the half. Ladarius Halton, that just snapped his string of free throws at 9 in a row, and he missed them both, in fact. McGetty going to work. One-on-one. Boy, it's a good thing Dupay got out there, or Avery was going to launch one.
I think Dupay finally recognized it doesn't matter where Avery's standing, he's a threat.
Anything past midcourt, he's a threat. McGetty's going to try one. Short from three. Brand in the right spot at the right time, and he's got a chance to add one.
That time, Elton Brand just muscled his way under the boards and would not be denied. Brent Wright not doing a good enough job to step back. Here's the shot right here by McGetty. And you see the position Brand had. He was right under the basket with Wright on his back. Nothing Wright could do.
That was sheer muscle that time by Brand.
And you take a look at the second chance opportunities, 11-0. A lot of them created by excellent offensive rebounding, 12 offensive rebounds for Duke, and a lot of them in the hands of Elton Brand.
Elton Brand's three-point play has matched Duke's biggest advantage of the night. They're up 13 with 3:56 left. Brand can do a little bit of everything, including getting it out on the break.
The studio checking first half action. Pittsburgh and St. John's. Vontigo Cummings looking up for Attila Cosby, like Attila the Hun. Cutting St. John's lead to 3. Colin Charles to Marvis Thornton just before halftime. St. John's up 8 at the break.
All right, Larry, we'll check in with you and Quinn in about 4 minutes. 46-33, our score, a 13-point advantage. Elton Brand, a three-point play just before the break. I don't know if Grant Hill would agree with that sign or not. He's probably here tonight. He usually is. He isn't working right now. So,
who needs NBA basketball? The owners and the players, if they want to get paid. Wake up, fellas.
Eddie Shannon trying to keep Florida in this game. Not on the floor right now as Dupay will run the point. Double team on Dupay. He's in trouble, and he calls a timeout. Pressure got to him. With 3:43, 20-second timeout. Florida could ill afford to lose possession there, that's for sure. They need some offense right now. Avery and Langdon, the two long-range artists. Avery has 4 threes in the half. Langdon has a couple.
I'll tell you, the key to those leading scorers is the opportunities that they've received off of the second chance rebound.
Coming up Sunday night, Dan Marino and the Dolphins take on Vinny Testaverde and the Jets, top spot in the AFC East at stake. And then Monday night, Steve Young and the 49ers take on Barry Sanders and the Lions, your exclusive home for NFL primetime football, ESPN and ABC.
Kind of snuck that one in on
him. Yeah, it did. Miller way outside. Miller got it back. Nice feed down low to Stoll. Nice court awareness by the freshman Mike Miller.
And finally an offensive rebound for Florida. They have to do a much better job of getting those second chance opportunities, the easy ones, to take the pressure off of the half court set.
Right now Florida would love to get this thing in single digits at halftime and would have to feel good about it, I would think. Brand is fouled by Eddie Shannon, who tried to swipe it as Brand went through the lane.
And Brand is so strong, even though Shannon got a hand on it, Brand continued that grasp, and really Shannon was just hanging on.
Duke is ahead of its regular pace as far as scoring. Right now they're still 3-10 remaining in the first half. They're averaging 94 points a game, and they're closing in on 50 here, and we're not even close to halftime. Elton Brand with 6 points, coming off a great game against North Carolina State. He was 8 out of 14 from the floor and 10 of 15 from the free throw line for his career high night. 26. Got them both.
I kind of think the two previous games, Cincinnati and Michigan State, a bit frustrated him. And he recognized that maybe he's got to move a little bit more without the ball, get himself in better position and hold position.
48-35. It remains a 13-point ball game. Drive in the lane. They're going to wave it off. Too bad. Good looking play.
And he did a nice job of trying to avoid by switching to the left hand. Take a look here on the drive, straight down the gut. Oh man. Oh man. I guess from that angle, it looked as though there was a bump right there. There wasn't even contact.
And his third foul to boot. So that puts Mike Miller on the bench for the rest of this half, takes away another scoring threat for Florida and gives the ball back to Duke. And they're looking inside for their 50th point to Burgess.
Well, obviously a call like that means an awful lot to Florida. You take your leading scorer and put him on the bench at a time when you can use him and when he seems to be getting on track.
Stoltz going to try three, blocked by Burgess. McGetty pulls it down, 3-on-2. Carowell reverse layup. Burgess to follow. Poetic justice. He's the guy that led it, stole it on the other end. He scores it on a stick back. It's a 17-point game. Nice kick out to Shannon. He'll try it three. Carowell clears it off. Right now, Duke looking like the number three team in the country. Avery again. I got it again.
Giving Florida some of their own medicine in transition, getting the threes in the flow of the game, great ball movement. Duke's operating on every cylinder.
They can do it from all over the court, can't they, Lenny?
Well, absolutely. We're going to take a look first inside. You know, down low right here, nice job of moving the ball. Good positioning by Burgess, and he asks for it. Avery finds him. And then, again, in transition, first time to Carowell. He misses, but a great follow by Burgess. So you see, they finish nicely, and Mike Krzyzewski's exhorting his team. Come on, baby. Shane Battier following suit. Great cheerleading.
And Avery dropped in his fifth three-pointer of this half.
And you take a look at the eyes of the Duke players, and again, you talk about the loss in Cincinnati. One of the things that Duke lacked in the first half, particularly when they went down by 19, was an intensity. They weren't playing with a pause. Tonight, you couldn't accuse them of that.
Teddy DePay, you see why he is a scorer and will be at Florida as he was in high school. He just buried the long-range three. Momentarily quiets the crowd. Avery. Oh, my.
There's nothing you can do.
6 threes for Avery. 20 points. We have a minute till halftime. And he's perfect. I don't know if I've ever seen anybody go 6 for 6 in a half. Inside foul, either Burgess or Maggette in low. It's Maggette. Picks up his second. Coming up in 54 seconds, Larry and Quinn will be along with the Courtyard by Marriott halftime report. Pittsburgh and St. John's going at it. You saw a little taste of that earlier. They'll preview top-ranked UConn and troubled Temple. Those are some of the stories, along with the scores and highlights of other games that Larry and Quinn have got for you in just under a minute. What a display by Duke we have seen in this first half.
And unfortunately, we're not seeing the best of Florida right now. Mentally, they're in the game, they're attacking, they're doing some good things, but they just can't knock down any shots. You can attribute that in part to probably the mental pressure, the anxiety that they've suffered under this Duke attack. But the other side of it is, you got to give Duke's defense an awful lot of credit. Florida hasn't been getting very many open looks.
Almost unbelievably, this game started 8-2 and then 12-5, Florida led by 7. And it's been all Duke since then. James is trying to get in the act.
And man, you can see the bounce in Duke's step right now. We talk about a killer instinct. I think they're starting to believe that they know what it takes to put somebody away.
There's a three on the other end. Halt drops in his first field goal of the ball game.
I mentioned a bounce in the step. The players are for Duke are attacking the basket. They're making passes. They're doing it all with an enthusiasm that obviously you like to see. When you're up by 20, that helps.
I'm waiting for Domzalski to back over there in the corner and take a three.
You got a long wait, I'm sure.
I think so. He sets a pretty good screen, though. Carwell on a fader on the baseline, and it drops in. Everything's going down for Duke right now. What a first half performance. William Avery's at 6 threes in 6 attempts in the first half to lead Duke to a 63-41 halftime lead. Larry Beal, Quinn Buckner standing by with our halftime report. Guys.
All right, thanks, Brad. Wow, you know, we were sitting here watching the first few minutes of the game going, Florida's kids are really hanging in, then all of a sudden, boom, Duke reels off a dozen points.
Larry, it seemed to me that all of a sudden Duke got into their own mindset, which was, first of all, let these kids, let's find out who they are. We're at home, we're an experienced team. And then Florida, on the other hand, tried to play at Duke's pace. And Duke's pace is an experienced up-tempo pace as opposed to what Florida had. And how can you beat 6-for-6 from the three-point line when you're looking at William Avery?
And it's pretty tough for Billy Donovan's kids when guys are taking like two steps across half court and shooting threes and making them. What do you can't guard them
you
for,
can't guard
for the whole court. The Courtyard by Marriott halftime report is coming up. Scores and highlights. We'll check out Pittsburgh. Already pulled off a couple of upsets, trying to knock off St. John's tonight.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of NCAA basketball is brought to you by Interstate Batteries, the official battery of the family car, and by Audi and the dashing and daring beautiful A6. Can one car change the way you...
Saddle up.
This halftime report is presented by Courtyard by Marriott, the hotel designed by business travelers.
Welcome to the Courtyard by Marriott halftime report. Larry Beal along with Quinn Buckner. Two teams that have been pleasant surprises this season, Pittsburgh and St. John's. The Panthers, as Quinn saw in person down in Puerto Rico, with a couple of upsets as they knocked off Xavier in Kentucky, trying to get St. John's here. Both teams in the top 20. There's Vontigo Cummings with the layup. They were tied early on. Mike Jarvis checking out Cummings. Nice look. Attila Cosby with the slam. St. John's coming back. Artest. Tyrone Grant, nice move in the lane and gets it to go. St. John's was leading by 8 at the half. Grant had 10 at the break. 38-30, they've just tipped off starting the second half.
You got to like what's going on in St. John's. I think Mike Jarvis has a good team. I think the only question mark, Eric Barkley, is he old enough, experienced enough to lead that team?
Fun team to watch. Syracuse, speaking of fun teams to watch, at West Virginia, first possession of the game. Javis Johnson with a miss. Marcus Gorry does not, with authority, throwing it down. And Jim Boeheim concerned. Alan Griffin breaking up the pass. Love Jason Hart's game.
Yeah, you got to like this game. I think most importantly, Boeheim has got to make sure his team stays emotionally ready to play like that loss they had to Ohio University.
Well, they're up and down the Cuse. Alan Griffin hits his third straight three, capping an 11-0 Syracuse run. But the Mountaineers, Gail Catlett's club, coming on. Brooks Berry, nice up and under move. And it's 44-37 at that point. And look at this. It would be a huge win for the Mountaineers if they can hang on with 10.5 to go.
I think that's a classic example of what we're talking about, just not being prepared to play. But Gale Catlett does a good job. And you're going down to play on somebody's home court, you're subject to get yourself beat.
Villanova and Seton Hall, Big East opener for both of these clubs. And it's all Hall right now, 44-25. Wisconsin and Temple. Check out the Badgers. Up three, Ty Calderwood from way out, knocking it down. Wisconsin leading 9-3. This is a three-point shooting contest. NC Oriental. Badgers, all their points were coming on threes. They were leading 18-8. Sean Mason is feeling it. And John Chaney's going, what is going on here? Get my clipboard, draw something up for Pepe Sanchez with a beautiful jumper. And there's the coach in the second half. The three-point bombs continue. NC Oriental.
You and I were talking about this game. We figured it's going to be a slow-poke game. Instead of look at it, 53 points, 46 to Wisconsin's ahead, knocking down three-pointers from everywhere.
We thought this was going to be first team to get to like 15 points wins. Michigan and Eastern Michigan. And the Wolverines leading 54-39. Wolverines struggling early in the season, but have this one in hand. And Bradley with a one-point lead over Penn State. Game two of our doubleheader tonight will match UConn and UMass. We'll take a look at that one, put the spotlight on Kevin Freeman when we come back. Courtyard by Marriott Halftime Report. Last game, UConn played on the UMass campus, January 30th, 1990. All UConn, Chris Smith, Scotty Burrell, John Gwynn, remember Rod Sellers? Everybody getting it done. Huskies coach Jim Calhoun not crazy about playing games in Amherst. UConn won that game 94-75. They've dominated the series, winning 7 in a row, 15 of 16. When you talk about UConn, and this is game two of our doubleheader, by the way, everybody focuses on Richard Hamilton and Khalid El-Amin, but they've got some other guys who can beat you.
Well, Larry, I think in order to be the kind of team you're talking about with them, this is the number one team in the country. You've got to have somebody else on the team. What they have here is Kevin Freeman. Quick, comes up with the steal here, gets the great finish. Intensity, defensive pressure is the kind of thing they have. Posted up. Kevin Freeman gets down on the block, gets the pass over to Vosko for the finish. Again, versatility here. Khalid El-Amin pushes the ball up, gets it out. Freeman finishes on the layup. Versatile players, you've got to have somebody in there that keeps it going in a variety of ways. Kevin Freeman is that person for the Huskies.
UMass has got a lot to worry about as far as the opposition and as far as themselves, they're concerned. They're 1-3. It's kind of where you know you're going to get a Mac attack from Monty Mac. He's averaging 21 points a game. But what's up with Larry Kentner, only 11 points?
Well, I think the real key is this is a senior. Take a look at his numbers last year as compared to this year. Down almost 4 points, two solid rebounds, and field goal percentage down 7 points. But no rebounds against College of Charleston. This is a senior. That is inexcusable for you to have anything like that. This is the guy you expect to make plays for you when he's not even a factor in the game. I think that disappoints his team and particularly his coach, Bruiser Flint.
We'll see if he's a factor tonight. This game is the border war, so it should be good. What do you think? UMass, do they want to be the team to dethrone number one UConn? Yeah,
oh,
baby. That's coming up at 9:30 Eastern.
Igor.
The Courtyard by Marriott, Halftime Report. The best college football players in the nation, Hall in the Hardware. Tomorrow night on the Deuce, it's the Home Depot College Football Awards Show, hosted by Chris Fowler and the Game Day Gang, 8 Eastern on ESPN2. Start your Saturday with Big East Hoops. We got a battle between West Virginia and Villanova. Then at night, Kentucky and Maryland. How good are the Terps? But Dick Vitale, I watched him this weekend, he officially proclaimed Steve Francis as the bomb. So he must be pretty good.
He's at least the bomb. He's an outstanding player. What I admired about him, having not played much in high school at all, this guy has fit into a system and really makes Maryland one of the top three teams in the country.
All right, that should be fun to check out. All right, we're going to come back. Second half is straight ahead. Duke in control, 63-41. They've been bombing away and dunking away. Brad Nessler, Len Elmore, back in a flash.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of NCAA basketball is brought to you by Chrysler, engineered to be great cars, and by Norelco, for an unexpectedly close shave, put it to the test.
Halftime at Cameron Indoor Stadium, third-ranked Duke 63, Florida 41. Brad Nessler and Len Elmore back with you. I'm the guy without the jacket because it's about 115 degrees in here. That seems like how hot Duke was shooting three-pointers in that first half, Len.
Well, they certainly had a lot of open looks, and when you shoot from 25, you're going to get open looks. But the bottom line is that they were able to execute their offense in half court and stretch the defense. Defensively, though, they did a nice job at critical junctures in taking the ball away from the Florida guards. Here you see a great double team by Duke, and that was indicative of the point where Duke turned this game around. They created turnovers as we look here, and also the offensive boards. That
you,
number right there,
rank,
19 second chance points off of 14 offensive rebounds.
Our shell first half statistics, and they shot better, did Duke, from three-point range than they did from two-point land. 67% of their three-pointers. I don't know if anybody could beat them if they continue to play at this pace. 63-41 as we start the second half. Dupe, Halton, Haslam, Wright, and Miller, who's playing with three fouls, on the floor for Florida. Nice entry pass in low. Haslam, chance for a three-point play. That's a good way to start things off.
And it's exactly the way they started off the game, getting the ball inside. What Florida wants to do is establish an inside-outside game. You get an opportunity in here, you get a guy hot inside that forces Duke to kind of collapse their defense a little bit. Nice positioning there by Haslam. And once they start to collapse, it makes the three-point shots for Florida that they're going to need to get back into this ballgame. It makes them a lot easier.
I would think they're going to have to try to keep going inside because Brand now with three fouls. Here's the guy that had the hot hand in the first half. William Avery had 20 at halftime. And Langdon wasn't exactly cold either.
And Dupay paying an awful lot more attention to him wherever he goes.
Tough catch by Brand in low, and he's got a chance for a three-point play.
Well, we talked about at the beginning of the telecast, you got to do your homework early against Elton Brand. You got to get him outside, step him away from the basket before the ball gets into position to go into him. Right here, he's able to get Haslam on his back, still have a foot in the lane and go up strong. The freshman is going to learn that if you give a guy like Elton Brand with his skill and his strength that type of position, you're going to wind up having a seat on the bench very quickly.
Brand completes a three-point play. Lenny, Brand's not the tallest guy in the world. He just plays bigger than 6'8".
He's got a long reach. His reach is equivalent to that of a normal 7'2 guy. You get it? Normal 7'2. But he plays with such smarts, utilizing his body to shield people off. That helps him with that lack of center size.
And Langdon picks up his third foul. So two of Duke's starters with three, and Brand and Langdon. That was a good entry pass by Mike Miller, and Haslam sort of threw it up there, drew the foul, and a chance from the free throw line to get a couple.
And despite the score, we're seeing glimpses of what Florida has to offer going forward. I mean, these are young players. These are freshmen playing in the most hostile of territories, and they're still able at times to execute. What Billy Donovan wants to do is to bring it all together, have them able to do it on a 40-minute pace.
I'd say get them while you can, because with how young they are and how much they probably will improve, as you said, as they go along, and then guys like Brent Nelson and other recruits coming in next year, they already have early commitments from some big-time players, and in years to come, it's going to be fun to watch Florida Gator basketball, as fun as it's been to watch Steve Spurrier's Florida football. Ball out of bounds to Duke. I'm just waiting for Avery the first time he tosses one up there. I want to see if he's cooled off at halftime. Brand has it. You know that. Elton's got all five of Duke's second half points.
Nice little clinic by Elton Brand. That time he received out a little high, turned and faced and recognized the defense before he went into his move. Good patience.
Nice entry pass by Shannon in low, and it's Haslam who's putting on the second half show, as is Brand for Duke. So seven in this half for Haslam, five in this half for Brand. That's all our score.
Haslam tearing a page out of Brand's book, getting him on his back now.
Absolutely. Here they are against each other. Nice spin by Brand. They're not giving Avery any room yet. Carwell creates a shot.
Well, that's enough to take your heart. You do such a good job defensively. You don't foul. You get a hand up on the guy, and he still makes the shots. But when you play Duke, they will break your heart like that.
Miller, the only Florida player with three fouls.
Miller showing a little point guard skills, leading the offense right now.
He can handle the ball. Double team. Kicks it out. Right on the drive. Everything worked about that play except Wright didn't convert, and now he's going to pick up the foul to boot. That's his third.
And he's getting a pat on the back by his team. It happened right out in front of their bench. They appreciate the hustle. You hate to see a guy, you know, get penalized for that type of hustle, especially when you're down by so much and you're trying to get back into the ball game.
He comes out. Stolt goes in for him. So two Florida players now with three. Duke with a 22-point lead. 17:45 to play. Langdon packs it into Brand. He's backing in. The wheel on the baseline. And Miller clears off the miss.
And that time Haslam did a much better job of not giving up the ground, forcing Brand to turn and fade away.
Stoltz, a good three-point shooter. Didn't get that one, though. Somehow the rebound underneath goes to Parker. He got another one. And finally it goes in. Miller tipped it off the glass.
Well, what do you say about 6'4 Major Parker in there amongst the trees?
It's a major jumping, that's it. 20-point game. Battier, not a big score. They would like to see him get a little bit more involved in the offense. Avery, here we go. He hasn't cooled off, Lynn. 7 for 7.
There's a time when you just feel it. Anything you lay up there, regardless if it's 2 feet or 32 feet, is going in. William Avery's got that feeling.
He had 30 points in the game you were talking about seeing up at the Great Alaska Shootout, which is his career high. Parker, chance for a three-point play. But I don't know if Avery's ever had a night like this from three-point land.
Well, see, he's on balance right now. Every time he receives, you know, he's got 1 foot forward. He's balanced. He's not drifting off to the side. These shots are coming within the offense, and when you can do that, that's great.
That's his career best three-pointers. Previous best was 6 against Notre Dame, but 7 tonight. So he has done himself one better, and we've got a long ways to go.
And once again, they've come within the offense. It's not as though he's going outside of himself or outside of his scheme.
23 points for Avery. The lead is 20.
Thought he was going to raise that.
I did too. Eddie Shannon knew that and got all over him, and now, though, he fouls him. Picks up his second foul, does Eddie Shannon. Been relatively quiet tonight. He hasn't had to do much with his counterpart in the backcourt doing so much scoring. Miller, rebound off the miss.
That time Miller tried to force the issue a little bit, couldn't get through. Haslam, nice move.
Absolutely. And a chance for a three-point play again. Great move on the baseline.
This young man is definitely a surprise if you haven't seen him, folks. Here's a freshman that, you know, is quite reminiscent of Elton Brand. Take a look here. The quick move right there. Nice little spin. Got Chris Burgess on his hip. And once you get him on your hip, you can lock the defender. You make your quick move. He's frozen.
15 points for Haslam. And a chance to add to it right here. Part of that Miami Senior High School. A great program down there, having won 3 straight state titles. And he caps a three-point play, makes it 73-56.
In the studio on a night shaping up to be filled with upsets, Wisconsin trying to knock off Temple. Mike Kelly with the steal for those Badgers. Up to Andy Kowski for the two-hand jam. And down goes Temple, their fourth loss in a row as Wisconsin beats them. And Syracuse in the process of falling to West Virginia. Might UConn fall next in game 2 of our doubleheader?
Oh, what a setup that was. A lob by Larry there. He wants us to answer that. Well, we don't think Duke's going to fall here unless Florida comes from way back. There's 16 to go. Brad Nessler and Len Elmore.
Trouble does come in threes.
That's right. You and I were talking off the air about Temple, tough schedule, maybe too much, huh?
Well, I think what happens is you wind up playing these tough teams, you lose some games, your confidence starts getting down, but there's no rest for the weary. A lot of teams will schedule a couple of cupcakes in between to let guys win, do well, and feel good about themselves. Unfortunately, Temple's been smothered by their schedule.
Duke's got a very tough schedule. Did it that way on purpose as Mike Krzyzewski, as Parker knocks in a three. We had back-to-back threes now from Langdon and Parker. And Mike says, we wanted to see a lot of different styles and a lot of different brands of basketball, prepare ourselves. You know, Duke just doesn't look at the ACC race or the ACC tournament. They're looking big picture, like maybe a national championship. With that in mind, they're playing like a champion tonight. Battier chips it in.
And the other side of the ball, Billy Donovan schedules a game like this after five relatively easy ones in his own state just to see what his kids are made of. Unfortunately, there are only a couple of junctures in the first half where they didn't respond the way Billy Donovan would have liked, but that cost them, and now they're behind by a lot. You take a look at Trajan Langdon, nice up fake inside, tries to do a little Jordan-esque move, and Shane Battier is right there to bail him out.
Battier picked up a foul on the other end, his third, so now Langdon, Battier, and Brand, all with three personals for Duke. May or may not be to Florida's advantage as we continue the next 15 minutes, but Florida's going to have to get as hot as Duke, if that's even close to possible, to get back in the ballgame. Miller's a guy that can shoot outside.
See, now you got to call something on that just by the mere fact that Miller went down, and I would consider that a flop, but the officials have to make a call because it impedes the offensive player if, in fact, it's not an offensive foul.
Stoll hears about it as he threw one up that didn't touch the glass. Langdon on the other end had it blocked by Stoll. He got it right back for Florida.
And I say that because it seems as though they're making some calls out there that may or may not have an effect on the game. They got to be consistent.
Three-pointer rims out. Brand had a hand on it, lost it to Miller. Miller will try it again. Got it this time. And one for Miller. Foul on Battier's is fourth.
I mean, you take a look at it and recognize it's a no call or non-call right here. But Shane Battier goes down without any contact. You see how Miller goes down as well. It could have affected the pass. Now here he goes up strong. Continues the fight for it. That certainly had an effect on his ability to get the ball up.
So Mike with a chance for a three-point play. As we said, Battier now at four. And Miller. Five this half, 11 for the game.
You know, you kind of understand when the game appears to be out of reach that you let some things go. But, you know, with 14, 15 left in the ball game, and you're Florida, you still think you got a chance. So every call counts.
Brand doubled. Carawell on a runner. And the battle. And this one might be a possession error situation as Wright comes out of the pile with the ball. And Frank Scagliotta looks at the arrow. And Duke ball.
Along with Haslam and Parker.
Duke shooting 71%.
That
wow.
Is amazing. And the fact is, the two-point percentage, that tells you that Florida's defense is not that bad. Duke has gotten opportunities. Florida stayed in front of them. They've gotten a hand in the shooter's face. But what's happened is the Duke three-point shooters have stepped out of range. You know, they're hitting shots from 25 feet or more, and really, there's no defense for that.
The guy that's been bombing away from long range has yet to miss outside the arc. Again, he pushed by Holt.
See, I like the job McGetty did on that particular sequence because he could have settled for a long-range jump shot, but he put the ball on the floor and continued to work his way for a better one, and certainly trying to create situations. This is an opportunity for Duke players, particularly young guys, to work on their games to get better.
Brand way out on the wing.
It's also an opportunity for Duke, once again, to keep putting the team away. You know, you don't want to let him back in. We mentioned the Michigan State game where in the second half, Duke let Michigan State back in the ballgame and made it a close one.
To a degree, they've sort of let Florida back in this one with 13:36 left. Don't forget, tomorrow night, 8 o'clock on the Deuce, the 8th Annual Home Depot College Football Awards Show. Chris Fowler, Lee Corso, and Kirk Herbstreit for the awards given for the top quarterback, best all-around player, and a lot more. They'll be down in Florida. Hope you join them at 8 o'clock on the Deuce tomorrow night. 78-62.
Considering Florida can hit those threes with regularity, averaging about 9 made threes a game, you know, this kind of score, they can come back lightning quick.
Parker almost thought he changed his pivot foot, but he goes in and scores, and he has 8 this half, 10 for the game, and it's 78-64. I mean, that doesn't sound like much when you consider it was a 23-point difference not that long ago. Avery, he missed one. And Haslam took one to the eye. Inadvertently, somebody trying to swipe the ball swiped his eye instead.
I think they got 2-for-1 shot because DePay is hurt as
right.
Well.
Grab the Kleenex. They both have tears in their eyes.
If you take a look here, Avery doesn't like the fact that DePay is playing close on him. So he creates a little room.
Might be a contact problem, too.
You know, the comparison has been made between DePay and Steve Wojciechowski, which I think is unfair since Wojo certainly established himself in that category of elite point guards.
Miller, ill-advised pass in the paint. Here comes McGinnity.
That should have been a tech.
It
well.
Is.
Okay.
Carl Hess just called it out by midcourt.
That's all you want, a little consistency. Excellent job by the officials on that one. A little showboat by Corey McGinnity. He's young, but he's got to learn. You see, pointing to your head. William Avery saying, hey, man, wake up. Well, Nate James, I should say, on the turnover. And again, we say Duke finishes better than anyone in the nation. They certainly do, but chin ups and a slap on the window is not the way you finish an excellent play.
So technical, sends Florida to the free throw line, and Stolt does not convert.
Talking about Wojo again in the comparison to DePay, on that particular play, though, DePay made himself a pain in the rear end like Wojo did to opposing guards.
Wojo did that for 4 years. He's doing it in Poland now, playing professionally. 80-65. Loose ball, McGinnity. I don't think he'll do it this time. He missed it.
You're right. And you know he was thinking about it.
And the crowd just seems to get louder now.
They take a look again. He knew. He just had to make this an easy one. No showboat or anything.
Eddie Shannon pulls up, went through some traffic. Miller underneath. Miller playing solid this half, 13 for the game. He hadn't played in a couple of outings with that bad ankle he hurt the last week of November in practice. Langdon had it stripped. Domzowski, rather. And a follow. Yes, sir.
And guess what? He almost
he
is called
almost
again.
Did it again. You're right. 15-point game. Miller trying to jump stop. He forgot the jump part, the stop part, rather. .43 left in the ball game. Corey McGinnity with a high wire act. It's 82-67. Duke.
Nobody loves cars.
82-67. Duke holding on to the 15-point lead.
Here's Corey McGinnity once again going strong to the hole. And now you see why. I mean, there was no doubt about that one. Little chin-up action.
Almost did it there.
He
let
held
go
on
in the last second.
Yeah, he held on a little too long on that one, for my take.
David Henderson talking to him on the bench. Mike Krzyzewski will have an in-depth conversation with him, I'm sure, either later tonight or tomorrow. Meanwhile, Duke with a lead with 11 and a half to go. Brad Nessler and Len Elmore from Cameron Indoor Stadium. Trajan Langdon fades in the lane, pulled out of midair by Brent Wright.
A lot of battling going on down there between Battier and Wright. A lot of grappling and tussling. You can see it again, putting his hands on this Battier.
Florida trying to get it to 13. Miller lost the handle. There was a reason, they say, a foul on Dubzowski.
Well, last night at during the Indiana-Kentucky game, Brad, you guys had a chance to see somebody come back.
Yeah, Indiana was, it looked like they were dead in the water and hit three-pointers in about the last minute of play, a couple by Recker and then one by Dane Fife, and sent the game to overtime.
Just saw the Toledo Xavier score, and what has happened to Xavier? I mean, here's a team that's done so well in the past, really had high expectations. I know they lost their leading scorer, Darnell Williams, but losing to Toledo after a tough loss against Purdue, where they turned the ball over 20, about 26 times. You know, their backcourt is failing them right now. They've got to regroup.
I also saw West Virginia's Big East upset of Syracuse. And now, Florida fighting back into this thing. It's the closest it's been this half.
Well, the Hoosiers did it with threes last night.
Avery, man in front of him, fell down, and he made it pay. New school record is 8 3-pointer in 9 attempts.
I tell you, you give Chris Battier a lot of credit for putting his body on the line. But, folks, that wasn't one of them.
Here's Avery, as you saw Brent Wright fall down in front of him, and boom.
Usually you're accustomed to seeing people fly by after you give a head fake, but not crawl by.
Avery on the drive leaves it off for Brand in close, and it's stuck.
Jump ball, water ball, the ultimate.
85 to 69, almost the midway point of this half.
Greg Stoll returns.
Don't forget UMass and UConn following us. Third-ranked Duke looking to be on their way to their eighth victory, but Florida hanging in there. But as Lenny said, they need some three-pointers pretty soon to start falling for them.
And that's part of the flow right there, just moving the ball. Shannon should be looking for it. That's what they're doing.
Stolt does. And he got it. First of the night for Greg Stolt. His 181st of his career. He's a guy that's probably going to take over the all-time three-point shooting spot in Florida history. And they're going to need all of him and then some. Foul.
And right now, Duke has got some great matchups because they're just too quick in the back for guys like Stolt. Put it on the floor, go to the basket. They're going to get caught putting their hands on. And Miller as well.
Miller got the fourth foul called on him, and he's going to have to sit. Back to a 13-point game again. He is going to be some kind of player just with the performance he's put on tonight, and he's doing it on an ankle that's about 90% against the number three team in the country. Langdon had it blocked by Parker out of bounds.
Hey, that Parker's an athlete. He's played excellent defense. He's going to force on the boards offensively for Florida.
Here comes Maggette, and the student section comes to life. Battier sits, and the high-flying Corey Maggette, who's flown a little too high once tonight.
Oh, he's young.
Young and impressionable.
You got to account for youthful exuberance.
Midway point, second half. Carwell needs some help. Avery. Carwell, nice drive. Didn't finish it off. Avery free. This one short. Florida trying to cut the lead down to 11. And a foul underneath on Maggette. Maggette picks up another foul. Don't forget, coming up next, as I mentioned, the MassMutual U game. Number one, Connecticut, taking on the Minutemen of UMass. It's our game two tonight. You see Rip Hamilton. You'll see a lot of him for Jim Calhoun's Huskies. 21 a game right now. And Mike Tirico and Dick Vitale are waiting patiently. Well, I don't know if there's any such thing as Dick waiting patiently, but I know Mike is.
Don't worry, guys. We're almost finished here.
Najee with the free throw.
We may almost be finished, but we could have a wonderful finish. Florida keeps inching back.
They do. If they can get it to single digits, you're going to be able to hear a pin drop in here momentarily. And still got another possession to do that, depending on what happens for Najee, the 6'10 junior. He got them both. Good job from the line. He's really improved his free throw shooting since last year. He struggled badly. He's made it an 11-point game.
Switching on every cross, every pick is what Florida's doing again in an attempt to stay in front of the shooters.
Inside, no good. Carawell came down with it, trying to go back up with it, and he's fouled. And Najee's the guilty party. This is as close as it's been as I dig through my rubble in front of me since it was 35-23. So got to go back a long ways to find an 11-point game, in that case a 12-point game. But Florida 22-30 from the free throw line. Duke coming in shooting 75%, 10 out of 13, now 11-14.
Well, that's an interesting figure because Duke has 9 players in double figures in free throws. They attacked the basket aggressively. Tonight was one of those aberrations, man, where they just had opportunities from 20, 25 and were draining them. So why go to the basket when you can do that?
Carawell, one of the players in double figures, has 11. Langdon has 13. Avery has 26. Brand has 12. McGetty has 7. And Burgess 6. And James 7 off the Duke bench. That's their scoring so far to give them 87 and a 13-point lead. Here's a turnover. And Brand on the break again. Does it himself.
Well, Major Parker was the only guy back. And he sees that freight train come a rumbling. He said, oh,
he jumped off the tracks. Dupe with a left hand. Out of bounds to Florida. Boy, this is the second time Elton Brand's done this tonight.
That's right. And again, we talk about his ability to handle the ball at his size, and he's pushing it. And you take Major says, wait a minute, check on your comment.
Not an answer. 6'8", 265, I'm gone. Nice move by Haslam underneath. Brand blocked the shot. And a foul on Brand, and that's 4. And that could become huge if this game gets any closer.
I tell you, Elton Brand's going to remember Udonis Haslam.
You're not kidding.
It's like a mirror image of him inside. You take a look here with the nice face, and Haslam puts it on the floor. Nice spin, and he gets Brand on his hip. Protects the ball nicely. Watch here as he goes up. Watch his right arm protecting the ball just enough so Brand has to reach across him. Pretty good for a freshman.
His first missed free throw for Udonis. Here's Brand's numbers tonight, 14 points. Haslam, on the other hand, is 16.
And both of them active on the boards. Brand doing a nice job getting out, playing people, starting to break. A couple of good outlet passes.
Well, those two free throws didn't help Florida's cause any. They're still down 15. Avery kicks out. Langdon, 3. Got it.
Not only does he score, but he dishes as well. William Avery developing into an excellent all-round lead guard. Wouldn't call him a point guard.
Lenny Langdon and Avery have 12 threes between them. Langdon the outlet, McGetty!
Saturn coupe has been conveniently redesigned, so it's easier for your friends to get in. The world's first three-door coupe from Saturn. Wow. Why didn't anyone think of this before?
Take a look at a Pro Plan dog. Then, take a look at Pro Plan. Real meat is the number one ingredient in Pro Plan brand beef and rice and lamb and rice formulas, not corn like Science Diet Canine Maintenance. You can become part of the Pro Plan team. Call 1-800-472-7272 and make your dog a Pro Plan dog.
The top rushers in college football history have all won the Heisman. Archie Griffin, Herschel Walker, Charles White, Tony Dorsett. Now, one man has passed them all. Will Ricky Williams take his place in Heisman history? Or will one of these playmakers beat him to the podium? The Heisman Trophy Award Presentation Show, Saturday at 7:30, only on ESPN.
It's a battle in New England when the top-ranked UConn Huskies, led by Khalid El-Amin and Richard Hamilton, look to feast on the upset-minded UMass Minutemen. It's a border war, and it's heating up. Coming up next here on ESPN.
Mike Krzyzewski looks out, his team up 20. Just over 8 to play in the ballgame, and it's been a three-point display by William Avery and Trajan Langdon. Between them, 12 threes on the night, including 8 by Avery, a school record. A record that was co-held by Bobby Hurley and Trajan Langdon until tonight. Parker blocked by Brand and lost it off his foot.
Well, I mentioned before the break that William Avery, not quite a point guard, but a lead guard because of his offensive prowess. A classic point guard is going to push the ball up, is going to look to distribute and then create if nothing else works. William Avery has the ability to look for offense first to create offense.
Eddie Shannon short on the three-pointer. Avery pulls it down. He wants an alley-oop to McGinney.
And then, of course, he can create for others as well.
Could see that one coming. Halton trying to quiet the crowd. Got his own rebound. Goes right back up with it. And a walk on Haslam. One thing you can say about our perch up here, you can see plays developing. We saw this one coming almost before McGinney did.
They made eye contact as soon as Avery received. He saw what was happening. Take a look there. He sees it all the way. And that's what I mean by lead guard. You know he's got offense, and now he has the ability to take a look at McGinney, who may have been flying a little too high right now. Got himself a little shaken up.
That time maybe he could have gotten away with hanging on the rim because he did get undercut a little bit, but after having it happen to him twice, a technical call once and almost the other time, he decided to hit the deck instead, and he might have hurt the back of his leg just a little bit.
That's why you got to save those rim hangers.
All right, don't waste them.
Not that either of us would ever know about it. Well, second.
You would.
Let me speak for me. Yeah, but the rim would have broken when I was playing.
Brand missed in close.
They didn't have the rip-away, tear-away rims.
Nate James missed with a left-hand hook.
In fact, they didn't even have dunking back in the mid-70s.
That's right. You had to lay everything in.
Yeah. I mean, there were some alley-oops, but guys would just go up and gently drop them in. I mean, David Thompson would have the rim around his chest.
Right.
And crammed it in.
He'd be worried that he'd miss it by dropping it from his chest down. Stoll picks up the foul. His third.
Fouls on number 25, Major Parker.
McGinney showing his unbelievable athletic ability tonight. I didn't see much of that last week. He came back from Alaska with that virus that's really kind of made its way all the way around the Duke team. He didn't play very well last week.
Yeah, Shane Battier started out with it. But you can see McGinney get some excellent tutelage from another fine Duke forward in David Henderson.
That's right.
That's the one. I'm sorry, Brad. That's the one thing that Duke has is maintained a connection with their tradition. You got some great Duke players on the bench assisting Mike Krzyzewski. There's David Henderson right there.
You saw Trajan Langdon at the free throw line. He's got 18 points, and he is now 43 points behind David Henderson on the all-time Duke scoring list.
Some of the other assistants, Quinn Snyder,
Johnny Dawkins.
Great Johnny Dawkins.
Not a bad bench right there. You could put a decent team together. You could even let Krzyzewski play point.
And I know they're still playing. I know when a guy goes down for Duke that Mike calls on one of these guys to get out there and practice with them, because they're all three in pretty good shape.
Stoll to the free throw line. By the way, Langdon on the other end, 4 for 4 tonight. And will not hurt his 95% free throw percentage for the year. Haslam comes back in.
See the tattoo on his right arm.
Diesel. Yeah, he's played like it tonight. Stolt got one. Struggled from the free throw line a little bit tonight. He's a 89-90% free throw shooter normal. 98-75, the next one. The Cameron Crazies will go crazy with the 100th point.
We talked about at the beginning of the game that one of the things Floyd would have to do is keep William Avery from turning a corner. Well, he's made that a moot point with his ability to stand outside and bomb.
And a foul on Miller, and that is it for him. He's going to have better days, but it wasn't a bad one. 15 points against Duke at Cameron's not bad.
We take a look right here. Little contact. Wow.
Ooh, little, real little.
Gotta let him play.
They don't call that in South Dakota. In fact, they don't call that almost anywhere else.
There's grabbing the shirt. That's what it was. And I think you have to call that one. Grabbing the back of the jersey.
He's grabbing his own jersey now. He's fouled out with 15 points. Good-looking young fella, isn't he?
Yeah, oh, he's definitely a player. I mean, there's no question about that. This is a tough night for Florida. They had some opportunities. They really missed a lot of free throws at critical points when they could have drawn even closer, maybe even get to 10 or in single digits when Duke broke out to a lead. And each time they missed those opportunities, the Blue Devils made him pay.
Domzalski can be the guy to get the student body into it right now if he hits his second free throw, his first point of the night, but the all-important one to them right now, and number 100 coming up. And as I said, you can hear me talking in this arena as he does it. There's 100 for Duke. Final inside. Duke by 25. Still 6:08 left for young Billy Donovan and his young Florida Gators. But there's what they've done tonight. Dupay and Halton, the guys that haven't quite held up their end. Miller and Haslam. Haslam looked very, very good tonight.
Well, the two guards, Dupay and Halton, they met with the initial thrust of the Duke defense, the onslaught. And you know, they had to work under extreme pressure. They also did a nice job of getting the ball inside, particularly to Haslam. So on one hand, they may not have been able to score, and a couple of turnovers that led to Duke runs really hurt Florida, but there are some little battles that Florida can say that they won, and part of it is the play of the big people up front. A couple of times, some pretty good defense by their guards. And overall, it's been a learning experience, and that's what Billy Donovan really expected, to see how his guys react so he can adjust accordingly.
And a blocking foul as Langdon takes it down court, and Parker picks up the foul. Well, maybe not. Trajan Langdon just said, that's bad. And Mike Krzyzewski said something like that.
Well, Langdon left his feet. The defender has to be set before the offensive player comes down for it to be a charge.
Whatever discussion, it is a foul on Parker.
Once the guy leaves his feet, you can't move underneath him. You have to be set.
It's a double foul is what they call. A foul on Langdon as well. Whoa.
What?
That's why Langdon said that's bad, and Mike Krzyzewski's still talking about it. They would have raised more of a ruckus about it had it not been a 23-point difference on the scoreboard, I'm sure. McGetty wide open on the wing. Duke with Baghetti, James, Avery, Domzalski, and Carowell, who's got it in hand. 12 on the shot clock. Shot clock is not going to factor tonight on either side in a high-scoring ACC-SEC matchup. Avery. It's too close for him, but it's not too close for Baghetti, who's put on quite a performance in the second half.
Well, what Mike Krzyzewski is looking for right now is effort. He certainly does not want his guys letting up, even though they've gone out to a huge lead.
Parker hits a three, his second three of the night, 13 for him as we approach the five-minute mark, 102-80.
One of the measurements of effort is offensive rebounding, and Corey Baghetti is showing it. He's still in this ballgame.
Yep. Duke has Michigan Saturday night right here. You'll see it on ESPN2. Michigan was a winner tonight over Eastern Michigan. Five on the shot clock. Avery kicks out. Baghetti will try it outside. Got it.
And there you see some of the point guard skills that William Avery has, the ability to penetrate and dish.
Foul on Domzalski. It'll be his third. Don't forget, UConn, a top-ranked team in the country. Boy, if they play as well as the number three team in the country is playing right now, UMass will be in for a little bit of trouble. That follows us in about 4.5 minutes.
You get the feeling when you look at the Duke faces that there's not a lot of satisfaction with this win, that somebody's trying to figure out a way how we can get better. You can just see it in their
right.
eyes.
It's the way they are. They can't get much better than they have tonight from three-point range. In fact, they're closing in on a school record. I don't think it's out of bounds to say they might get it before this one's over.
Well, that's the mark of the champion. Not satisfied. Always finding another way to improve.
Getty on the rebound. Avery, Langdon, Brand, James, and Baghetti on the floor for Duke. Here's a wide open look for James. Told you they still might get that school record. They're only one short of it now. 16 threes for Duke. In the lane, Parker hangs, rebound Baghetti. And he'll slow it and let Avery do the honors of bringing it up. It's 108-81. Who held up that sign a little while ago that says, who needs the NBA? We got an NBA score.
An NBA blowout.
Ooh. 16-23. School record is 17 against North Carolina two springs ago.
And the amazing part about that is the 20 attempts to have 70% with over 20 attempts.
Steal by Parker. Eddie Shannon, nice feed in low. A block shot by Baghetti, but he got him with the body. And I think that's five on Baghetti.
Well, when we were in Alaska, we talked about the emergence of this young man right here because we saw flashes of brilliance. The ability to handle the ball, obviously his extreme physical talent, which for a little bit seemed to be raw. He's refining it every day. On that block shot, the only reason he was called for a foul is because his arm came down. If anybody's going to block shots and you got that kind of rise, go up there and tip the ball. You have an opportunity not only to block the shot, but gain possession.
Avery comes out. That'll do it for tonight. 9 assists and 26 points. Night for William Avery, the sophomore. Duke record 80% and 8 threes, 8 assists. Free throw comes out of there.
And he couldn't even manage a smile coming off. He's either fatigued or, once again, not satisfied. Probably thought he should have been perfect.
Langdon waits on Baghetti. Was not Baghetti's fifth foul, by the way. Nice look, no look to Elton Brand. Brand's got 16.
I know it's the most difficult call in the game, but these charges, somebody's going to get hurt.
Duke with a steal. The lay-in by James. Now it's a clinic. 30-point game.
You know, the point I'm making is with all the high flying around the rim, a lot of guys are taking charges of flopping. You got to make calls to stop that because somebody's going to get hurt. It's not a critical part of the ball game. This game's over.
Heaps in there for Avery. Langdon waits on him to set the play with 2:20 left in the ball game. 30-point Duke lead. 5 on the shot clock. Brand, baseline jumper. And the battle underneath between Langdon and Shannon. And Shannon's going to have the foul called on him.
And he also got a lecture, too.
Yes, he did. UConn, UMass. Next up, in a couple of minutes, Trajan Langdon goes to the free throw line, 4 for 4 tonight, 41 of 45 on the season. 41 of 43, I beg your pardon, on the season. Top free throw shooter in the history of the ACC at the line. And now Mass substitutions coming in for Duke. James and Maggette go out. Trying to make it 6 straight free throws tonight. Trajan Langdon does. He has 20 points. 2:14 left. All Duke.
The marvel of its aerodynamic.
With 2:14 left. And Len, this is an impressive looking third ranked team in the country.
Well, absolutely. They say youth will be served, but not tonight. Duke was too big, too strong, too quick, too experienced.
So they're going to win this one. They're going to go to 8-1 and certainly not hurt their number 3 ranking. Right now, we're going to send you to UConn and UMass in another big game. Mike Tirico and Dick Vitale. Guys, it's all yours.
William Avery. For 3. William Avery, a deep 3. He had 8 threes in the game. That's a Duke record for one contest. He was 6 of 6 from three-point land in the first half alone. Corey Maggette, the freshman, with the jam. Duke up 63-41 at the half. Second half, Maggette goes in for the two-handed slam. Too much celebration there as he taps the backboard. That's a technical. But it really didn't matter. Duke put it away. Maggette had 16 points. 2 more there. He went 7 of 11 from the floor. And Duke wins 116 to 86. In addition to his 26 points, Avery passed off for 9 assists. Coach Mike Krzyzewski, of all the kids on the court for both teams, Avery was just a level above everyone. That was one of the better performances here since I've coached. Duke now 8-1, while Florida drops to 5-1.
Bethune-Cookman and Charleston Southern, those schools not nearly in the class of, say, Duke. Yeah, the third-ranked Blue Devils occupy the next box on Florida's schedule. That one Wednesday night. The Gators take to Cameron Indoor, where it is always a little bit crazy for an opposing team. William Avery came out smoking. Gets that three-pointer there, then another one. Look how far this guy is beyond the arc. 8 three-pointers. That's a school record. Duke up by 10. More from Duke. Trajan Langdon knocks the pass away, saves the ball. Corey Maggette, business end of the alley-oop, throws it down, 33-25 Duke. Don't forget about Avery, left wide open. What's wrong with the Florida defense? They're leaving this guy so open, he's just knocking down threes all night. 6 for 6 in the first half. Second half, Maggette took over, takes it home for the jam, and then slaps the backboard along the way. More Maggette, call this one Maggette with meatballs. Blows the jam right there, makes up for the miss, though, with the big follow slam. The Gators did not box out. They did not guard from the outside. They did not keep up with Duke in any way, shape, or form. Another jam for Maggette. And boy, they love it. And by the way, those are your future employers. They're your lawyers and your doctors, and they are crazy. Come basketball day, 116-86, the final. Duke wins it over Florida. Avery at 26, 8 three-pointers, also dished out 9 assists. Duke's 116 points matched the highest point total ever allowed by Florida, which loses for the first time this year.
Beat Florida by 30, and there were some incredible plays. William Avery even shoots a school record 8 threes for 26 points. A great individual effort on a team full of stars.
I think we're a very unselfish team, and we recognize, guys' strengths. Like Corey Maggette, we know we can throw the ball up and he'll go get it, And then when I'm coming down, I'm always looking for Trajan Langdon, spotting up, Elton Brand and Chris Carroll, Chris Bird, they're filling in lane, we're finding each other.
Well, Duke hosts Michigan this Saturday at 9 at the indoor stadium. The Carolina Hurricanes are smart.
Respected, I think.
Performance against previously unbeaten Florida. Check it out now when William Avery was red hot, hitting his first 7 straight threes, 8 three-pointers in all, a total of 26 points for Will. Corey Maggette handled things on the inside. Boy, did he ever. A slam fest for him. Duke 116-86, and this team knows how to score.
We got a lot of players who do different things, a lot of drivers. We got some really pure shooters, in Trajan and Will, and good post player in Elton. So it's kind of hard to kind of guard us sometimes because we're so versatile.
And finally, there's a new...
yours truly have been some glory years, Coach.
Shall we?